So we have been doing this survey every 3 years. This is the one of its kind survey in India, because it's basically asking India Inc. about their own views about the cost of capital that they use for their own internal decisions. And every year we've had increased participation. This year we had about 200 respondents from India Inc. across sectors and across size of companies and segments of industry responding to this survey. And based on their responses, we've compiled this, and this is the report that we have just released. So Tirthankar, your views on the report?
I think, thank you, Naveen. It's been an absolute pleasure partnering with EY for us at the National Stock Exchange. And it goes without saying how important cost of equity and cost of capital is for investment decisions. It is absolutely the primary hurdle rate for companies in terms of their investment decisions, and for investors, it is the primary benchmark, the return that they expect on their investment. And it's also in that sense a very important benchmark for the long term growth of equity market. Set a hurdle rate that's too hard, and then you expect too much unfavorable return from companies. And if you set it too low, you do end up losing what might be important opportunity. So it's very important that we have a sense of the cost of equity of companies. And again, it's also important that apart from professional valuers like Ian Wang, Ernst & Young, it's important how companies look at this very important variable. And from that perspective, a survey is gives you a nice juxtaposition between the opinion of a professional entity like EY and what companies are thinking. So I'm very pleased to be.
No, exactly. I think from our perspective, we do this as our daily bread and butter. I mean, that's what we do. But I mean, for us also, it's important to benchmark as to what the companies are looking at themselves. And yeah, from that perspective, it is very critical. Yeah. And I think while these surveys are there globally, I think India, it's probably one of its kind that this is done.
Clearly, what has happened is, over the last 6 years that this survey has been done, you have seen a sort of drop in cost of equity. Now, would you like to elaborate on why we've seen this drop in cost of equity, Naveen?
Yeah. So I think, if we see, last three surveys, every year it has come down. Of course, this year, the reduction, if we look at it, of course, there was a bit of a reduction on the risk-free rate also. I mean, interest rates have somewhat come down 50 basis points. And, when we compare with our own benchmark, with our EY benchmark, so we think, look, 10-year government bond yield is about 6%. And we think the market risk premium is 7%. So that's about 13%. So, there has been a gradual reduction in the economy and interest rates. So that's sort of getting reflected. But I must say that, a little bit of disappointment is there. We thought that there will be a sharper reduction since we last did the survey. Last time when we did, it was around demonetization and post that. And so, we thought that there would be some more reduction in this. So that, to that extent, it has been sticky. And also, when we ask, one of the questions we ask all the respondents is, what do you expect it to be in the future? And most of the respondents don't expect a change. So that's a little worrying. One would think that, slowly it'll keep on further reducing. But that's, people think that now it's going to be stable now. So that's a little, I would say, a little disappointing. I mean, one would have thought it would go down further. And what do you think, macroeconomic perspective, and, what do you see around the world? What do you think, what were your thoughts on this?
So, the key point there is, ever since the global financial crisis, when you had major central banks go into a zero interest rate policy, global interest rates have been, fairly low. At this point, there's about, $13 to $15 trillion of assets globally, which have, which yield negative return. So, clearly, a risk-free return, so to speak, has lost the premium that it once had. And this also means that, people are expecting lower from a cost of equity perspective. So, from a macro perspective, I think there's a clear reflection of how growth rates have come off over the last several years, and this segues into how companies' expectations from the future, or return expectations, have also been coming down. And look at that. I mean, this is a triennial survey. It has happened from 14, 17, and now 20. You've seen India's growth rate come off in a general downward trend, and I think this is being reflected from my perspective in companies' return expectations as well.
Right.
Yeah. Naveen, I wanted to sort of we did look at cost of equity from a global perspective and from an India, you know, macro country perspective. But if we delve deeper into sectors, what's been the sense on sectors?
Right. So I think one point which stands out is in all these three surveys, every sector has seen either a reduction or some have been somewhat flat. But generally, sector by sector, everybody has seen some reduction in the cost of equity. So that's good. It's not that, you know, some sectors have belied the trend. But yeah, within the different sectors, there are still some which are very high. There are some which are lower. So I think those anomalies or those distinctions are there. I mean, there is a bit of a variation between various sectors of the cost of equity, at least what they think about it.
So if we delve into some of them, say startups or real estate, which have come out to be having fairly high return expectations, what's been the sense there?
Right. So I think this is the first time we covered startup. I mean, till now we've been, you know, they've been really not so large from an economic perspective, from Indian perspective. But now, I mean, clearly they are a dominant sector in the economy. And, you know, actually when we see, we are not surprised that startup is the highest, although they become so dominant. I think the reason for that is, you know, if various studies which are done on startups point out to the fact that they are still a fairly risky sector. I mean, if you see cash flows, profitability, it's still not there. A lot of disruption within the sector. They disrupt the traditional sectors also, but there's disruption within the sector also. And, you know, for example, AICPA points out to some studies which say that at the very start, a startup can have a cost of equity as high as 50 to 75%. And even at the IPO stage, it's about 25%. So, you know, we were a little surprised to see that sub 20%, that cost of equity that the sector participants think they have. And the other point which you would have noticed, of course, would have been that, you know, if when we asked others, if you were to invest in startup, what kind of premium would you ask for? And that was most of them said between 5 to 10%. So if we add about 14% on 14% normal cost of equity, about 5 to 10%, you know, you're talking about 19 to 24%. So that brings in, you know, the range, ballpark range of what you would expect, you know, some of these companies to have. But otherwise, yeah, within the sector, I think there's a growing, you know, the sector is growing. So that's probably reflecting in somewhat lower cost of equity. But I mean, I would think that this would remain as a somewhat higher cost of equity sector only.
Even going forward until the sector sort of matures.
Correct. When they mature, they become a part of some other sector. So they may become a part of some, you know, healthcare or, you know, consumer or something. So they may dissolve a sector of their own. Yeah.
No, in another sector where we saw very high, cost of equity was real estate. What's the sense there?
Right. So I think the good part in real estate is it has again come down every year, every survey. But I think, and that's a very, that is an anomaly because, and that's also been pointed by one of the speakers, which is Darshan Hiranandani, that, you know, if you look at a built up unit, so if you look at a house or you look at a mall or you look at an office, and, you know, when it is put up, when it is fully built up, you know, they are the lowest yield assets. So a yield is 6-7%. And, you know, on a housing, once it's built, you can get a loan at 6-7% these days. But, you know, when the developer is going out to get some equity funding, he's getting at 16-17%. So, I mean, there's a whole range of risk there. And I think the reason for that is, of course, you know, the structure of the real estate sector is changing a lot now. But, I mean, traditionally, it was fairly high risk, fairly disorganized. I think that the top 8-9 players had maybe 10% share or even lower than that. And that's, I mean, for example, this quarter, we saw a sharp increase in the share of houses sold by the top 8-9 builders. And I think the other significant change in the sector is RERA, which has come in and which has, built a structure around the industry. And so I would think that this would definitely go down. But yes, I mean, given the fact that, you know, RBI frowns upon lending to this sector and, you know, the dominant source of funding is not available, I think that pushes up the cost for all segments and including for the equity. So that mostly explains it. But one would expect from an economic perspective, and I think you probably better. I think this is one of the most dominant sectors, and you know, this pushes up construction and this thing. So it's really important that this sector has a lower cost of equity.
I fully agree. I think one of the points you made was very pertinent in this regard, that RERA and various other factors that are leading to one might call it formalization, one might call it concentration of this sector, might eventually lead to even further lowering of the cost of capital in this sector, and that has clearly cascading effects, favorable cascading effects, higher growth path of the economy, given how important the real estate sector is. One other question I had on sectors, Naveen, was surprisingly, pharma has seen a fairly high cost of equity, cost of capital. Why exactly should pharmaceutical companies have high cost of capital?
Siddhankar, I must confess that even I am a little surprised by that. And pharma is one of the most defensive sectors. I mean, come rain or sunshine, you will need pharmaceutical. And you could have a fantastic domestic economy growth, or you could have a slow economy growth. And pharma, usually one would say, will have a similar kind of a growth. It's not going to change. And so the riskiness is very limited in this. And it's probably one of the more defensive sectors. I mean, it's viewed as a defensive sector. But in this survey, it came out that they do have a high cost of equity. And although some of it was driven by the fact that it's a pharma and healthcare, so on the hospital side, maybe the being capital intensive, the cost of equity is higher. But I think it could be a little bit of a reflection of the fact that the pandemic has had sort of a little bit of change in the sector, where from a defensive, it's probably becoming a more aggressive growth sector, and it's becoming more into focus, introducing some volatility, a lot of investments getting into it, and also focus shifting from which kind of drugs to what kind of drugs, and also that could be some of the factors. But overall, it is still surprising. Yes.
And if you look at the other sectors apart from these, you already mentioned that there's a significant divergence, but there's also, one might take that takeaway a point that there has been a secular drop in cost of capital across sectors.
Correct. And that's I think the good part. I think except for information technology, which has remained stable, and that needs to be dissected, why we don't know really. But others, all sectors have pretty much shown some decline. I mean, maybe the extent of decline is smaller or larger, but there has been a decline. Even traditionally, sectors which were always low cost of equity, like FMCG, have also shown a decline. So that's positive. That's good.
On long-term growth rates, Naveen, it has fallen to 4%, and we've seen last 2 years they were quite difficult. But do you really see 4% as a long-term growth rate, being okay given India's growth trajectory and what our growth expectations are?
That's again surprising, and that's something that probably I want to understand your perspective as to why. Because if we look at it, it's a 5-year period when we forecast and then we put a long-term growth. And these are, again, nominal forecasts. We are not, all companies usually do a nominal forecasting. And so, what do you think about it? And to me, it looks very low, actually. And I don't know why this has been going down.
So, I'm jaundiced with the view of a macroeconomist, a top-down macroeconomist. So, let me try and, venture to answer this question from that perspective, from that prism. We've seen growth rates in India, real growth rates, come down from around 9% levels to averaging 5%, even at the pre-COVID level. Of course, after that, we faced a recession, and this year we're expecting decent numbers. But it's taken over the last 10 years growth rates to come down secularly over from 9% to about 5-odd%. And these are real growth rates. Having said that, you're very right. These numbers for long-term growth rates are nominal figures. So when people point out 5% real growth, they are, when you include inflation, it is still 9%, 9 to 10% nominal growth rate. So, it is, I think, a clear reflection of what companies are expecting from a long-term perspective. My understanding is that, about 10 years of degrowth has made growth expectations quite conservative. Will they continue to be so is a big question. But I think over the three surveys that we've seen, I think this is a clear reflection of companies lowering their expectations, lowering their hurdle rates, and that's reflecting in the long-term sort of growth rate being pared down to 4%.
Right. So yeah, I mean, if you've been like last 7 years, you've been every year lowering your growth, and you know, and then you make a forecast and you want to approve a project, you don't want to take the same, you don't want to make the same mistake. I mean, you don't want to say, look, after 5 years, also I'm taking 7% growth, but you know, I know that it's not happened in the last 7 years. So that's probably, maybe I completely agree with you. That's probably the reason. Yeah. Better to be safe than sorry. Yeah.
That's it. I mean, I just wanted to add on this. I mean, back in 2003-04, around 7 period, companies growing at 20% earnings growth was quite normal. I mean, for Nifty Universe, you generally expected 20-25% earnings growth. It seems a very far cry at this point. Yeah, so companies have
Yeah, I mean, now we see double digit itself is celebrated in the market. So and that's sort of showing up in this growth rate also. Yeah, growth expectation also. Yeah.
So one, we are in the second wave of COVID at this point. One can't really not mention the elephant in the room. So how have companies' expectations, or how have companies adjusted to the pandemic, and how has that reflected in the cost of capital survey?
Right. So I think the surprising part, and which we I would not say surprising, but very intelligent part, is that, you know, when pandemic happened, there was initially when you stock markets also fell like anything, but then the markets realized it's a short term impact and came back mostly, and now it's pretty much at the same level. So I think most of them focused on the fact that they did two things. So either they changed the forecast in the projections, they lowered the projection for 1 year or 2 years, or they built multiple scenarios. And I think the higher proportion changed forecast, a lower proportion built multiple scenarios. And I think also, I would think that's also because when the survey was done, it was January to March period. So it was still open and second wave had not happened. And if we maybe go back and ask the companies again, maybe there'll be some slight shift towards doing multiple scenarios, given the uncertainties involved. And, you know, trying to say, okay, what kind of, do we go with one path only? Because, I mean, that's so uncertain right now with third wave or what will happen. Or do we just do multiple scenarios? And that's not only at the top line level, you know, even at the micro level. So if you see companies, certain costs have come down significantly. One of the revelation of this period has been that costs have been cut. And some of them are temporary, but many of them could be permanent. And, you know, every company could have a scenario on that. Like, I mean, this discussion we are having in a non-pandemic environment, we would have sat in one office and done that. But, you know, now a lot of these discussions, a lot of technology use, which has cut costs. So, I mean, some companies are saying maybe some of them would be carried forward even post-pandemic, and some reduction in costs would happen there. So I think multiple scenarios are there on some of these cost behaviors also. So I think fairly good response of companies to understand, look, this is not something that requires a change in cost of capital, which is a much more long-term issue, a more permanent issue. It's more a change in methodology, a change in approach that is required.
I think that's fair. I mean, look at the overall growth rate also. You know, in 2020 or fiscal 21, we saw growth rates come off to a recession for the first time in 40 years in the country. Held to about negative double digits. This year, second wave, the growth expectations are near 9-10%, like a big jump. But in terms of, did the pandemic have any impact on the long-term growth path of the economy? Most forecasters have not changed that. So what we are seeing at a company level is also reflecting at a macro level, that people expect this. People saw this big dip, and then there's this big jump, and then you're back to or steadily growing back, converging to the growth path that was available pre-COVID. This is what has been actually at a macro level as well.
True, absolutely. Reflecting in the company's response also, and at the macro level also, all the economists are saying that.
So the next point, Naveen, how have companies actually, estimated this cost of capital? What has been the methodology? Have you seen any change, or how have various sectors dealt with it?
Yeah, so I think one point we find, and which we are sort of, I mean, we find slightly strange in India compared to a lot of other countries, is the, reliance on hurdle rates more than the capital asset pricing model, which is the global model to set cost of capital. And, we see more people relying, or equal number of people relying on the hurdle rate vis-a-vis CAPM, which we find very surprising. So when we have an emerging market forum in EVA, when we discuss across countries. We find that it's not so much in many other countries. I mean, there's much more reliance on CAPM as compared to India. And so that's somewhat, I mean, I would think that that's not, I mean, see, the problem is if you have a hurdle rate, you try to take that hurdle rate for everything. Now you could do a very high risk investment, or you could do a very low risk investment. If you're taking the same rate, that sort of, you know, is not, I mean, probably will push the company towards higher risk. So that's not appropriate in a way, or you could miss out some very good opportunities because your hurdle rate is fixed to a slightly higher risk level. So I think that's anomaly which we think, you know, slowly will get more and more people will shift towards CAPM rather than just a hurdle rate, which could be set, you know, any which way.
Have you seen this in the 200 odd companies that were surveyed? Have you seen this as a trend in any segment that people
surprisingly, you know, the startup sector, which we would think is a younger sector, you know, fresher sector, I mean, there's much more acceptance of CAPM compared to the traditional sector. So that maybe shows that there's some change happening as the economy, structure of the economy changes, and, you know, more organized way, more theoretical way of looking things would also happen, you know, more right way of this thing. So that's surprising, and that's positive. That's a good thing. Yeah. I mean, we didn't expect. Yeah, one wouldn't have expected this in that sector. Yeah,
absolutely. But you know, across sectors, I think over the three companies to go more towards theoretical models. Maybe in the next survey, one would see a higher proportion of people using DCF rather than just a peer multiple.
Correct. And right now, you know, if we ask people, is DCF your primary method? Only 20% plus say it's a primary method. Most use it as a combination, which is also fine. But globally, also people want to use two methods rather than just one, because DCF also has its limitation in terms of lots of assumptions. But we would believe that, you know, a lot of people and a lot of sectors are very amenable to only DCF also as a sector. So they would do more of that. So that would grow. And maybe DCF along with multiples as a cross check, I think that could become more and more dominant. As of now, it's the other way, it's the combination of methods which is more dominant, almost 60% companies using it. So that could change. Yeah, let's look forward to it. I mean, interesting times.
Interesting times indeed. I mean, I think this report goes a long way in looking at one segment of the market where there's a, you know, it reflects what the market thinks is its cost of capital, what the market thinks, as you pointed out earlier in the at the, you know, beginning of our talk, about what should be the return expectations, what are the right return expectations. And that obviously leads into how equity markets behave over the, you know, medium to long term, and clearly how the macro economy also reflects. So
absolutely. And also I think at a practical level, it'll be useful for CFOs and all to, you know, benchmark what they are doing vis-a-vis their industry, overall economy. I think that as a benchmark tool, it is very useful, I would think.
No, without a doubt. I think you know, this report provides a clear, separate tool for a CFO to see how you know, the rest of the economy behaves. There are you know, what they typically see right now are market indicators, or they see, you know, typically see are economic indicators, but a reflection of how the rest of the, you know, peer group behaves, and that too across the rich data across sectors. And you know, not just cross-sectional, but also time series in terms of three separate surveys over 6 years gives a very rich panel, so to speak, for both academics, or I mean, I'm telling you, for academics, for you know, professionals, practitioners. I think this report has a lot of very useful implications.
Thank you.
It's been a pleasure, Naveen. Thank you.
Thank you. It's been a pleasure to talking to you. So thank you very much.